after his post graduation, he did his advanced fellowship in pancreas in Mayo Clinic. He has performed some excellent work in pancreas and has published widely. He is presently working as a senior consultant and in charge of the pancreas division at famous Asian Institute of Gastroenterology. So with that, I will pass on to Dr. Talukdar to take over and proceed with the deliberations today. Dr. Talukdar, you can put your questions on the chat box, and towards the later part, Dr. Talukdar will answer as many questions as are possible in the time frame. Rup Jyoti, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, and welcome to all the DNB trainees for this webinar. So before going to the medical management proper, let's look back a little into the history of chronic pancreatitis since its evolution of the first pancreatic ductal calculi to in 1678 to the most recent paper where biliary SEMS, multiple SEMS was found to be beneficial or as good as multiple plastic stents. So the point here is, if you see majority of the discoveries or inventions in chronic pancreatitis, be it the disease biology, be it the treatment, has been circled around or encircled around the interventional part, be it sphincterotomy, be it surgery. So all these blue arrows indicate the interventional studies or interventional discoveries, and the green indicates the medical discoveries. And that's probably why we still do not understand the medical part very well. And with the advance of the interventional part, be it endoscopy, be it surgery, the popularity of interventional treatment has becoming more and more robust in the recent years. And being young, to be gastroenterologist, you must also be interested in treating this treatment with different kind of endoscopic therapies, which is kind of the norm now. But if we look at the disease pathophysiology, it begins in the acinar cell, and as the time progresses, there will be progressive fibrosis, there will be different patterns of pain, and eventually there will be fibrosis, exocrine insufficiency, endocrine insufficiency. So it is very important to remember that the disease is not in the duct. Even though we are more interested to intervene in the duct and remove the stones or do a surgery, the disease is in the pancreas parenchyma. It begins in the acinar cells, probably a little bit of the ductal cells. And what we treat this patient are mostly palliative to reduce the complication of the disease. So in today's next 45 minutes or so, let us discuss what we can do about the medical part of the management. I think you must have had good lectures on endoscopic therapy, surgical therapy. So today, let us talk a little bit on the medical management. So if we look at the traditional definition of chronic pancreatitis, it's defined as chronic pain, malnutrition, diabetes. But over the last several years, this disease has been actually described to a systemic proportion. There are cardiovascular manifestations related to chronic pancreatitis, musculoskeletal manifestation. There is anxiety, depression, psychological abnormalities. So it's basically a systemic disease which affects not only the patient, it also affects his socioeconomic status, his family, his normal quality of life is affected. So what I will do, because it would be a very long talk to discuss all aspects in detail. So what I would do is to just talk about the salient features of the diagnosis, pain management, some amount of nutrition, endocrine dysfunction, and psychological manifestation. So I'll talk very briefly to the extent what you as a trainee or to be gastroenterologist should know, and also introduce a little bit of the new concepts. And we can discuss the other things in question answer session. Okay, so let's make a diagnosis. So usually, in referral center or also in primary health center, we see the disease or we see the patient who come at the state where he has some calcification strictures or some local complications along with the pain. And of course, he will have different grades of pain, different severity of pain, acute exacerbations. So to make a diagnosis in this stage, which we could arbitrarily say the intermediate stage, is not too difficult. A good transabdominal ultrasound or even a erect abdominal picture can show us this kind of a picture and confirm the diagnosis of chronic pancreatitis. So in this situation, two high-tech investigations or advanced investigations just to make a diagnosis may not be necessary. However, if we want to see the morphology of the pancreas, to see how much pancreatic parenchyma is left, or if we want to see the localization of the calculi. So these things should help us design the treatment or decide which treatment to be used or which treatment would suit the patient best. Or if we want to see a roadmap of the pancreatic duct, for example, if there is a stricture, at which part the stricture is, or if we want to see if there is any local complication and most ominously a pancreatic mass. So if these things are suspected, or if we want to these additional things, then advanced investigation modalities like a CT scan, pancreas protocol, CT or MRCP can be used. But for diagnosis at advanced or intermediate stage, just an ultrasound along with the clinical symptoms is good enough. But the problem arises where the patient presents in the early stage. And at this stage, it's very important to have a high index of suspicion. So whom do we suspect to have early chronic pancreatitis? Mind you, let me tell you that still now there is no definitive diagnosis of early chronic pancreatitis. There is still debate going on, still consensus guidelines are being attempted, but no one has reached any consensus as of now. So when to suspect early acute pancreatitis, a patient, especially young adults or children who has recurrent acute pancreatitis, a patient who has alcohol-related pancreatitis, even if it is the first episode, alcohol-induced chronic pancreatitis usually go on to develop chronic, or they already have very early chronic when they present. Recurrent abdominal pain, lipase amylase are borderline high, they do not respond well to the usual treatment. Patient who has chronic diarrhea or malabsorption and a family history of pancreatitis. So these are some of the causes or thing where one has to suspect that the patient may have early chronic pancreatitis. So how to diagnose that? So this is a situation where advanced investigative modalities could be helpful. For example, we can first start off with the MRCP. MRCP may show us very subtle changes, early changes in the side branches, some subtle irregularity in the side branches. But even at times, the MRCP may not show such changes, yet we suspect the patient might have early acute early chronic pancreatitis. So in that case, EUS comes to the play. EUS in that situation is a very extremely important modality, but I need to tell you about a word of caution. As I had already said, there is no unanimous definition of early CP. Endoscopic ultrasound tend to overdiagnose CP. So if you find a patient who is above 60 years and suspect chronic pancreatitis, you have to be careful in interpreting the EUS, because even age-related change may be seen in that patient. If a patient is having acute pancreatitis, you are suspecting chronic, you have to wait till the acute pancreatitis episode is resolved, because during the resolving acute pancreatitis phase, there are several changes which mimic chronic pancreatitis. And in that situation, we may label the patient as mistakenly as early chronic pancreatitis. So we have to wait at least 8 to 12 weeks after resolution or after the episode of acute pancreatitis to do an EUS to diagnose early chronic pancreatitis. And this is very important to understand, because now all over the country we see many EUS centers cropping up, which is good. And many new people are, the youngsters are coming up, which is very good. But then we have to keep in mind few of these important things so that we do not mislabel the patient, because EUS is again an operator dependent procedure, requires lots of expertise to reach a level of proficiency. Okay, so now let's move on to pain. Again, chronic pancreatitis pain, all of you are aware of, you have seen lots of these patients. These patients may present in two manner. One, it could be a presentation as an acute pancreatitis episode on the background of chronic pancreatitis. So these patients, that episode can be treated as an usual acute pancreatitis episode. The more problematic situation is the presentation with different types of pain without an acute pancreatitis. If you see these patterns, the patient may present with fluctuation, slight fluctuation. There could be a persistent low-grade pain with fluctuation. There could be persistent continuous pain with acute attacks. There could be no pain in between and then interspersed by acute attacks, and there could be undulating, fluctuating kind of pain. So these are the patients which require both short-term and long-term treatment. Short-term strategy is to reduce the pain in the acute situation, and long-term strategy is to keep the patient pain-free for a substantial duration of time. So how do you go for a short-term pain management? There are, again, no very good trial. I think there is only one good randomized trial from PGI Chandigarh, which have shown that tramadol hydrochloride is a good modality in short-term pain reduction in these patients. So here we can usually follow the WHO pain ladder. Usually paracetamol is not a very good modality in this kind of situation, even though there are reports of several people using that. If the patient has acute inflammation, an NSAID would probably be better. But if the patient do not have acute inflammation yet pain, a low potency narcotic like tramadol hydrochloride does give good results. And now tapentadol is another low potency opiate that has been shown to give good results. But again, I would like to emphasize that now we have seen all over more and more use of morphine-based derivatives, nalbuphen, buprenorphine, fentanyl. Those agents reduce pain in the short term, that's true. But then if we look at the biology or the pharmacology of morphine and its derivatives, it has a tendency to produce dependence. There will be narcotic bowel syndrome. The pain itself can be because of the narcotic bowel and not because of chronic pancreatitis. There will be constipation. And more importantly, a thing which is not very often discussed is morphine analogs, especially codeine derivatives, can cause mast cell degranulation. So mast cell degranulation is a very important component of the pathogenesis of chronic pancreatitis. Within the pancreatic acinide, the mast cell will produce mast cell tryptase, and that produces inflammation and activate the pain receptors. So in chronic pancreatitis, high potency narcotics like morphine, nalbuphine, fentanyl should be avoided as much as possible. If it has to be given, it should be in a hospital setting under strict supervision of the treating physician. And once the pain is gone, then the patient has to be shifted to the other modalities of treatment. And the patient has to be strictly instructed that they should not take this by themselves. Because many of the patients we see have the tendency to pop up a Alprocet or a Tramadol or a Contramol when they have pain, and eventually they turn up having a narcotic bowel syndrome. And that is a situation which is very difficult to treat. And what about the long-term pain management? So for that, let us look a little bit into the mechanism of how this long-term recurrent pain happens. So one of the most important cells in pancreatitis, in chronic pancreatitis pathogenesis, is the pancreatic stellate cells. So these are usually, these remain in quiescent state in a normal physiological situation. But whenever there is a pancreatic inflammation, be it acute, be it chronic, this gets activated. So this also gets activated by alcohol per se, by smoking itself can activate. In chronic pancreatitis, when there is a stone or a stricture in the duct that is causing pancreatic ductal or tissue hypertension, that has been shown experimentally to activate stellate cells. Trypsin autoactivation can cause, which could be related to genetic pancreatitis and inflammation. So what happens when there is activation? It produces lots of free radicals. Now, physiologically, our body is equipped to combat the high oxidative stress in the initial stage of the disease. So all these antioxidant defenses like glutathione peroxidase, superoxide dismutase, catalase, etc., will initially deactivate the oxidative stress. But as, because of this constant activation of the stellate cell and inflammation, a time comes when all this gets depleted. So the patient or the pancreas go into a pro-oxidant state, which further perpetuate the inflammation. They will activate the immune cell, they'll upregulate cytokine gene expression, and that again leads to inflammation. So this leads to a vicious cycle. And on top, if the patient is continuing to drink alcohol or smoke, or if the ductal obstruction is still there, this activated stellate cell will keep on producing free radicals, and there will be a cycle of recurrent inflammation. And that leads to the recurrent chronic pain in these patients. So when this oxidative stress and inflammation happens, the pain receptors within the pancreatic nerves and parenchyma get activated. So that is called nociception. And once there is nociception, there will be pain trigger that will be sent to the spinal cord and then to the brain. So logically, at this stage, if we can reduce the oxidative stress within the pancreas, that should reduce the activation of the pain receptors. So let us look at these studies. So there has been several studies over the years on antioxidant, and I think I have missed two or three more studies in this list, more recent. out of that, if we look at these two elegant studies, this was from Pramod Garg's group at Ames, published way back 10 years back. And this was a study that came out from Manchester from a surgeon, Siriwardena. But interestingly, if we see both these studies use the same antioxidant cocktail, which contain methionine, selenium, carotene, vitamin C, vitamin E, sample size were pretty good. The Ames study did show significant reduction in the pain-free days number of analgesic requirement, but the Manchester or UK study did not show any benefit. There was reduction in the oxidative stress markers, but there was no reduction in pain. We conducted a meta-analysis after that, to including all these studies using that particular combination of five antioxidants. And what we observed was there was a significant higher odds in favor of pain reduction. So when this cocktail of antioxidant was used, the overall result was in favor of pain relief. And that was proven by the fact that the number needed to treat is five. So in statistical terms, this is a marker of the effect size, the effect or power of the medication to reduce pain, meaning that we have to treat five patients of chronic pancreatitis with antioxidant cocktail to get one patient pain relief. So anything below eight is statistically supposed to be good. So antioxidant did improve pain in these patients. And I was already saying that it's only the combination of these five antioxidant preparations that had helped in pain reduction. There are other antioxidant modalities like N-acetylcysteine, glutathione. So those individually did not help the patients. And how long do we have to give this? We have to give this for at least 3 months. And if you see here, methionine is highlighted in red. So the minimum dose of methionine should be at least 2 grams for that antioxidant effect to happen, at least for 3 months. So why methionine? Why I'm stressing on methionine? So if we remember our biochemistry classes, there is something called the methionine cycle or the transsulfuration cycle. And this cycle is very important for exocytosis of the zymogen from the pancreatic acini to the pancreatic ducts. So in chronic pancreatitis, because of oxidative stress, methionine gets depleted. So the cycle gets disrupted, as a result of which the zymogen don't get exocytosed. So it will get activated within the acinar cell, and that will keep on causing small packages of acute pancreatic inflammation. So there is loss of exocytosis, pancreastasis, mitochondrial injury, endoplasmic reticulum stress, and inflammation. And that leads to chronic pain in this patient. So if we can replace the methionine, then this cycle will be restored, and then this inflammation will come down. So that is the rationale of using methionine. So if we use any antioxidant without methionine or without vitamin C for that matter, which is also a methyl donor, this patients won't be benefited. Now, I had talked about two studies. The Indian study showed response. The UK studies did not show response. So actually, the UK study taught us a very important lesson. It told us indirectly which patient won't respond, because the UK studies were patients were active alcohol abusers. They were smoking actively. Most of the patients were middle-aged to elderly, and all the patients were having on high dose of morphine derivatives. So if this patient, and even in the study from Ames, patients who were consuming alcohol and smoking actively did not respond. So is it beneficial for Indian patients? Yes, because in India, 70% of our patients are idiopathic chronic pancreatitis. Patients are young, and we do not have long-term narcotic use. Although recent times we are seeing, which should be avoided, again, I'm reiterating them, but overall the use of long-term narcotics is infrequent. So in our Indian patients, antioxidants are highly likely to benefit. The other group of patients where antioxidant may not benefit adequately is if the patient has a very long duration of CP. Why? I'll come to that in a while. But patients with a long duration of CP may not respond to antioxidant compared to a patient who has a short duration of disease. So methionine containing antioxidants should be initiated early on, when the inflammation is just brewing up and the patient has not gone into a very late stage in the pathogenesis. Okay, so then is oxidative stress alone enough to cause so much of pain? Given that the disease is a very long duration disease and many ups and downs keeps on happening in the natural history. So I had talked about sustained activation. So because of the inflammation, there will be sustained activation of this pain receptor, that is nociception. And initially what happens is when pain goes from these pancreatic fibers, it goes to the celiac ganglion, and it is relayed from the T5 to T10 spinal segments. So this is where the celiac ganglion relay. But what happens when there is sustained recurrent activation of these pain receptors because of recurrent inflammation, more and more pain stimuli come here. And eventually, again, I'm not going into the details, this is just broadly to understand, the several more segments of the spinal cord gets activated. So this is probably a stage where celiac ganglion will also not help. So we have seen many patients who do not respond to celiac ganglion block, or they'll have recurrence of pain very soon. So in these patients, even the fibers from the superior mesenteric ganglion or splanchnic ganglion would get activated. So at a certain point of disease, when the patient has a long-standing disease, many of them will complain of pain even after taking food. So what happens, even if there is stimulation, normal stimulation of the stomach or the small intestine or large intestine, they will perceive that as pain because of the central sensitization. So different phenomenon like spinal hypersensitivity happens, like inflammatory hyperalgesia, mechanical allodynia. And eventually, again, I'm not going into the conceptual details too much here. Finally, what will happen? Something called neural reorganization happens, where the whole brain areas which modulate pain or manage pain gets disrupted. So this is, again, a little bit of theory, what happens in pancreatic neuropathy. Maybe this could be an answer for a theory question. So there will be neural inflammation, there will be glial activation, there will be regeneration of the pancreatic and glial cells, there will be neural remodeling, autonomic nervous changes. These will result in phenomena like temporal summation, global sensitization, meaning any stimuli in the intestine can lead to or result in a perception of a painful stimuli. Same with mechanical allodynia, inflammatory hyperalgesia. So these are components of pancreatic neuropathy, the mechanism and the phenotypic effect that happens. And at certain point of time, nociception, neuropathy, and neuroplasticity will keep on happening together simultaneously in different proportions. And that is why it's very difficult to say which particular patient will respond to which kind of therapy at a certain point of time. Today, a person may respond very well with antioxidant, but after 6 weeks or so, 4 months, he may not. At that point, he may respond better to something like pregabalin. So this is the conundrum of chronic pancreatitis pain that precludes a definite prediction of a specific response to a treatment modality. So if these patients have pain suspected of neuropathy, the drug of choice currently is pregabalin. So unfortunately, till now, there is only one study from a group in Denmark who has published this paper quite some time back. And the dose of pregabalin, starting dose is 75 milligram twice daily. It can be incrementally increased to 300 milligrams for 3 weeks. And they showed that there was a significant pain relief. But if you see, even in the placebo, there was some response. Around 30% response was seen in the placebo also. So this again tells us, or this again reiterates the complexity of the pain mechanism. Now, the problem is how to detect pancreatic neuropathy in the day-to-day clinic. So one of the recent modalities which has some objectivity is called quantitative sensory testing, and there are a couple of papers that have been published recently. So what is done here, we give some pinpricked sensation to different dermatomes. So this is the T10 dermatome, the pancreatic dermatome, and with every prick, if the patient has neuropathy, there will be temporal summation. And then with every prick, the pain sensation or the pain perception increases incrementally. So that is temporal summation. And this is something called the pressure and pain detecting threshold. This is an algometer where we put pressure in those pancreatic dermatome and other dermatomes in the body. And the pressure at which the patient feels, just initiates pain, he'll tell us, we'll record the pressure. And the pressure at which the patient feels unbearable pain, he'll tell us, we'll record the pressure. And the difference will tell us how the patient is perceiving pain or what is the pain threshold. If the pain threshold is very low, the gap between the pressure pain detection and pain pressure detection will be very low. The problem is this is still a research tool, and I think in India only we are doing at AIG under research protocol, not a routine diagnostic. And also very few centers, one in USA and one in Denmark. Probably these three or four centers are using this. So this is not yet recommended for routine clinical use. So what to do then? Again, as I discussed, as time passes, there will be spinal hypersensitivity. More and more spinal cord segments will get activated. So what happens then? If more and more spinal cords are activated, the patient will start having pain areas involvement in a bigger area. More and more area in the abdomen will be involved in pain. The pattern of pain may change. There will be wider referral and there will be newer areas. And even for subtle stimuli like very low inflammation or even taking some specific food with intestinal activation, the patient may perceive pain. And the pain pattern will change in the character. It may turn like burning sensation, tingling, or some kind of pressure dragging sensation compared to their early onset pain, which was more of stabbing character. So if these are present, then these are soft marker. I won't say that these are objective, highly specific marker, but these will give us an idea that this patient is probably having neuropathy. And then there is another tool called the Pain Detect, which can be downloaded free in Google, and it can be used in your clinical practice. So this is a questionnaire that has been thoroughly evaluated for neuropathic pain in diabetic neuropathy, in radiculopathy, in osteoarthritis. There are few studies that has used this in chronic pancreatitis, including one or two of our studies. So it works in chronic pancreatitis to a certain extent. So if the final score is less than 13, the pain is unlikely to be neuropathic. It's more of nociceptive predominant pain. If it is more than 19, it's predominantly neuropathic. And if it is between 13 to 19, it's a gray zone, and we don't know what actually happens in that area. So these are few of the parameters or few of the tools that can be used to identify possible neuropathic pain. And based on that, we can decide the patient to start on antioxidant or continue with antioxidant or add on a pregabalin. What about pain recurrence? So again, this is a common problem we have all seen and faced in our clinics. Be it endotherapy, be it surgery, be it total pancreatectomy, patients are bound to come back with pain. With certain modalities, for example, for surgery, we might have to wait for a longer duration than endotherapy to see a recurrence in pain. That might give a sense that surgery is more durable and better, which has always been a matter of debate, surgery or endotherapy. We won't go into that today. And if we look at total pancreatectomy, even after total pancreatectomy, 40% of patients still continue to have pain or come back with pain. So why does that happen? If there is no pancreas, if there is no pancreatic nerves, pain should not be there. So this is where the concept of neuropathy becomes even more important. In these patients, the pain is probably happening in the spinal cord or in the brain. Now, what happens if we see such a patient? Usually what happens, there is a tendency if the patient comes back with pain after all these intervention, there is a tendency to put them to recurrent stenting or recurrent ESWL or recurrent endoscopic treatment. So there could be two scenarios. One scenario, if the patient has, for example, a persistent ductal stricture even after the initial treatment, the patient could have a new obstructive pancreatic ductal calculi, could have some local complications like biliary obstruction, gastric outlet obstruction, could have local complication or mass lesion. More ominously, it could have a mass lesion. So in this kind of situation, interventional therapy is beneficial. So when a patient comes back with pain recurrence, it's very important, extremely important to look at the pancreatic morphology. If there is a change in the morphology, obstruction in the pancreatic duct, or a mass lesion local complication, that is the right patient for interventional therapy, be it endoscopy, be it ERCP, surgery, or US guided drainage, or whatever you feel appropriate. But in a large majority of patients, the patient who has recurrence of pain already has an intact sphincterotomy, intact anastomosis in case of LPJ, and they have a clear duct or have many very small ductal stones, fragments, or soft stones that usually passes out through the wide open sphincterotomy, and they do not have any acute inflammation. Amylase lipase are normal. So what's happening in this patient? So these are the patients where the neuropathy has taken a upper hand. The neuropathic pain has become very prominent, and at the same time there is also inflammation going on. So this patient is highly likely to be benefited by a combination of antioxidant with pregabalin. So to answer this question, we had actually conducted this randomized controlled trial that was published 5-6 years back. So in this, again, I'm not going to the study design for lack of time. So this patient basically received antioxidant and pregabalin in a double-blind placebo-controlled manner for the first 2 weeks. And if you see here, the patient who got the combination had significant reduction in the pain score, significant reduction in the number of patients who had pain recurrence, and the complete proportion of patients who had a complete resolution was significantly higher. And the patient who did not get this combination in the placebo, they were actually more worse, and many of them, the pain was unchanged. And in the second part of the study, from the 3rd to the 6th month, we gave them open label antioxidant. Pregabalin was stopped because, again, long-term pregabalin has its own side effects. So if we see here, the patient who initially received antioxidant pregabalin continued to have a reduction in the pain scores. And I am not showing the data of quality of life. Other parameters were also improved, which means that when we start off this patient with antioxidant and pregabalin, pregabalin takes some time to work. And by that time, antioxidant levels will peak up, and then pregabalin starts working, reduces the pain, and then antioxidant maintains the pain response for a long duration. And in fact, many of these patients are still coming to our OPDs, and they report that either they're not having pain, and even if they're having pain, it's not very severe, it's manageable with one or two analgesic tablets. So now let's move on to malnutrition. Again, malnutrition is usually resulting from pancreatic exocrine insufficiency. So if we look at the physiology of the pancreas, the three most important dietary ingredients that requires pancreas for digestion is dietary fat, which is predominantly digested by lipase. There is a small proportion of gastric lipase, which is not a very strong enzyme, and the effect is doubtful. Dietary proteins, again, the predominant initiation happens with gastric acid in the stomach, but then pancreatic proteases play an important role. But even then, the whole intestine has several brush border proteases, which digest the dietary proteins. So pancreatic proteases is not the only enzyme to digest protein. Similarly, for starch, the majority of starch is digested by salivary amylase, not pancreatic amylase. So what is left is the pancreatic lipase. So this is the most important enzyme, which do not have a backup, and therefore dietary fat digestion requires essentially pancreatic lipase. So it is important to understand that pancreatic exocrine insufficiency and malnutrition is a problem of maldigestion, not malabsorption. So logically, it will mean that if we can replace the pancreatic enzyme so that the dietary fat and the other ingredients are digested, the malnutrition should improve. But before that, let's again see for a minute how to diagnose pancreatic exocrine insufficiency. Again, this is more of theoretical, actually, because none of these direct tests are conducted routinely anywhere in the world. I think at Mayo Clinic and some other centers in USA, and the research protocol are very infrequently the stimulation, direct stimulation test and endoscopic pancreatic function tests are done, but not routinely available. Secretin MRCP is coming up in a good way, but unfortunately in India we don't have secretin available. So what we are left, and the fecal fat quantification, CFA, this is actually supposed to be the gold standard, but again the technician has to handle 72 hours of fat, and it's really difficult, and no one wants to do that test, and again that test is not done outside of research setting. So what we have as the best current test is the breath test, the triglyceride radioactive carbon labeled breath test, where the patient is asked to take a triglyceride containing meal which is labeled with carbon 13, and then if there is exocrine insufficiency, there will not be digestion of the triglycerides, so it won't get released into the intestine, and the carbon 13 won't be released, so it doesn't come out through breath. So if it is less than 58% excretion, then it is a definitive sign of pancreatic exocrine insufficiency. Unfortunately, this test is also available only at one or two centers in the world. In India, we do not have it. So what we have in India is something called the fecal elastase, which all of you are aware of. But again, this is a very fallacious test, and the results should not be taken very seriously, except under specific circumstances. Because this has a tendency to be highly false positive in presence of diabetes, and this is positive, or the sensitivity specificity is good only in the patients having advanced chronic pancreatitis. The specificity has a range from 0 to 33, or 33 to 90, I think. So if the patient has advanced disease, we see pancreatic atrophy, we see ductal stones. In those patients, pancreatic elastase need not be done, because those are anyway bound to have pancreatic exocrine insufficiency. Patients whom we are suspecting early chronic pancreatitis, or patients with long-standing diabetes, those are the small subgroup of patients where fecal elastase may be helpful. But again, as I already said, it will mark exocrine insufficiency only in advanced disease. So it's important to understand that fecal elastase results should be interpreted with caution. So, as I had said, since exocrine insufficiency or malnutrition in chronic pancreatitis is a disease of maldigestion, if we can give the digestive enzyme therapy, the situation should be improved. So, the rule of the thumb is for pancreatic enzyme replacement therapy, again, this is something all of you know, is the right timing, which means that the food should go into the intestine, into the abdomen, stomach, and the duodenum, along with the food, duodenal delivery. It should be in the right preparation, enteric coated microsphere preparation, so that it is protected from the gastric acid and it passes through the pyloric channel, which is 2 millimeter, and the food chyme is 2 millimeter, and the dose should be at least 20,000 units with each meal, so it reaches up to 60,000 units per day. But is pancreatic enzyme replacement therapy alone to combat malnutrition? So what happens in real life practice? So many of you, I'm sure, have definitely seen patient, encountered patient who are on pancreatic enzyme, very high dose, religiously taking, yet they have malnutrition. They continue to lose weight or don't gain weight, right? So to answer that question, actually, we had published this, done this study over the last couple of years, published it recently. Again, I'm not going into the methodology in details for lack of time. What we basically did was we divided the patients into three groups. Group one patient were taking pancreatic enzyme supplementation very religiously, at least 25,000 units with each meal for at least 3 months. Group 2 patients were taking enzymes, but their doses were not very regular. They were from their own side because of various reasons, lack of financial issues, or lack of availability, or lack of response. They were not taking it regularly. They were taking, but they were not very compliant. And group 3 patients were those who did not take any enzymes for the last 3 months at all. Either it was stopped by the physician, or they were stopped themselves, or they were not even started. So when you saw the results, if you see here, more than a third of patients in all the groups had malnutrition. So even if the patients were taking these enzymes religiously, even in group A patients, almost 33-34% had malnutrition, which is similar to group C patients. Similarly, the change in weight were same in all the three groups, irrespective of taking pancreatic enzymes or not. So why was this happening? So when we tried to identify the factors using stepwise logistic regression, what turned out was alcohol, continuous alcohol consumption, and more importantly, low caloric intake had a very high risk of persistence of malnutrition even after PERT therapy, enzyme therapy. So these patients were not taking their food adequately. So that is the cause of their malnutrition, in spite of them taking these enzymes. So why were these patients not taking? So one of the most common things that we found out was these patients were advised to take a fat-free diet. once the patient is taking pancreatic enzyme, there should not be any fat-free diet. They should take normal diet, normal fat content in their diet, a well-balanced diet, because these are like an enzymes which requires a substrate to work. This is basic biochemistry. And for pancreatic lipase, which is the most important enzyme, fat is the substrate. So if the patient is not taking a dietary fat in adequate amounts, dietary protein in adequate amounts, this enzyme won't work. In spite of taking those enzymes, the patient will remain malnourished. Because of fear of pain, many patients stop taking adequate amount of food. CP is a chronic inflammatory state. There could be decreased appetite. And there are issues of depression, anxiety, which leads to low nutritional intake. So the rule of the thumb or the point to be made from this slide is, if a patient is on PERT, he has to be given a normal balanced diet without fat restriction. So if we restrict too much of it, we are actually harming the patient. At the same time, the patient should be given dietary counseling to take normal home-cooked meal. This was a very elegant study from Pramod Garg's group that was published several years back. And they had shown that even with good home-cooked food, good nutritional counseling, the patient maintains a good BMI. And then there are many micronutrients which do not require pancreatic enzymes for absorption. For example, folate, B complex, zinc, vitamin C. So if the patient is not taking adequate amounts of this in their diet, in spite of taking pancreatic enzyme, they will be deficient of all this. So this patient should be replaced, or this patient should be supplemented with these micronutrients, at least in the early stage of the disease, as till the nutrition is maintained. Okay, then maybe last few minutes, let's talk about the exocrine insufficiency or diabetes. So diabetes in chronic pancreatitis is called type 3C diabetes. So several new concepts have come up. Initially, earlier what was believed that because of chronic pancreatitis and fibrosis, because of the pancreatic atrophy, because of fibrosis, stones, parenchymal calcification, there is damage to the pancreatic islets, because of which there was reduction or absence of insulin secretion that led to the diabetes. But in the last few years, several studies have come up from different parts of the world, including our center here. And now the question arises, what is actually the mechanism? What are the mechanism of this? Is type 3C diabetes different from type 1 or type 2 diabetes? And if so, how they are? How to evaluate? What treatment to start? Is it insulin or OHA? So initially, because of the concept of acinar atrophy or acinar damage, islet damage because of fibrosis, insulin was used as the first line of treatment. Is it really true? So let us see what happens. So if you see these two immunohistological picture, the top one is a patient with chronic pancreatitis without diabetes. You see the center, there is an islet, and you see there are acinar cells around the islet, which doesn't look very healthy, and there is fibrosis. And the lower panel shows a section from a patient who has chronic pancreatitis with diabetes. Florid fibrosis, all these purple strands are fibrotic strand. These are stained by a stain called Meson's trichrome. And there are no acinar cells, but if you see these islets looks very plump. They are not atrophic, they're looking healthy. So that means the islets are there, but still the patient is diabetic. So here we conducted few studies on this kind of islets, and what turns out that these islets are, there is infiltration of Th17 cells which secretes interferon gamma. So when interferon gamma infiltrates these islets, they stop the secretory mechanism of the islets. Again, I'm not going into the details of the mechanism like PDX and JAK-STAT pathway. So what happens is, because of this inflammation, the islets stop secreting insulin. And then again, this is a more recent study from our group where we could show that there is a gene called BAC2. So if this BAC2 gene is repressed, if it loses its function, then the T17 cell mediated inflammation gets aggravated in the pancreas, and that leads to more advanced inflammation and more advanced disease, which results in more advanced diabetes. So what turns out that, so in at least in the early or intermediate part of chronic pancreatitis, the islet do not die. Majority of the islets are alive, 60% of the islets are alive, but they do not respond to glucose challenge. Only 2% of the response to glucose challenge is there, meaning that these islets are viable, but they are non-functional. So if we can make them functional, they will start functioning and the patient's diabetes will be improved or patient will benefit from a glycemic standpoint. So this is the concept or this is the rationale why islet, auto islet transplantation after pancreatic surgery can help in patient's glycemic response. And the other factor that inflammation can is responsible for the non-functioning of these islets is, again, this is a study that again we published recently, long-term follow-up studies on patient who underwent ductal intervention. So this patient, especially the idiopathic chronic pancreatitis patient who underwent ductal intervention, had developed diabetes at around 3 to 4 years later compared to patients who did not undergo ductal intervention, which means that if we reduce the ductal pressure by removing the stone or putting a stent through the stricture or doing an LPGA, somehow the inflammation will come down and that will lead to less inflammation, less infiltration of T helper cell into the islets, and that leads to less severity or of islet inflammation, which delays the onset of diabetes. So ductal intervention won't reverse diabetes or won't probably improve already existing diabetes. But if the patient do not have diabetes and then they go undergo this intervention for pain, diabetes will be delayed by 3 to 4 years, which is in a kind of good in this patient, because any little bit of help we can do to the patient would be beneficial for them. So how does type 3C diabetes differ from type 1 and type 2? Again, in type 2, we all know that there is insulin resistance, mainly peripheral in the muscles. In type 3C diabetes, there is predominantly hepatic insulin resistance. So that is very important. This is a new concept that one has to understand. In type 3C diabetes, there is hepatic insulin resistance because of the insulin receptors in the liver. Beta cell mass is reduced in both type 1 and type 3C. Beta cell areas is not as reduced in type 3C compared to type 1. Beta cells are less vulnerable to death, as I had shown you in that previous slide, in the early stages. And what is most important and what we can use in the clinic is the pancreatic polypeptide response. So this is the most distinctive hormone or most distinctive test that differentiates between type 3C and type 1 and type 2 diabetes. In type 3C diabetes, pancreatic polypeptide response is significantly low. So what is pancreatic polypeptide response? If we ask the patient to take a mixed meal, then there should be increased secretion of pancreatic polypeptide because of the proteins. But in chronic pancreatitis, that response, the difference between the fasting and postprandial pancreatic polypeptide is less, meaning the pancreatic polypeptide is not responding. So this we have just started doing in at AIG for some of our patients. Probably it will be available in other centers also in the coming years. So when we encounter a patient of chronic pancreatitis, it's important to look for the presence of diabetes. OGTT could be a good initial test. Otherwise, we can use the fasting postprandial blood glucose and HbA1c and follow the ADA criteria. It's very important to look for a postprandial C-peptide in these patients, especially if they are diabetic, because that would give us the idea of beta cell reserve. And if the C-peptide is good, if that means the beta cell reserve is good, meaning the pancreas is basically not functioning, but yet the islets are viable. So in this kind of patient, insulin may not be required. And of course, the pancreatic polypeptide response will confirm that these patients are having type 3C diabetes. So if the C-peptide is good, pancreatic polypeptide response gone. Contrary to the previous belief that insulin should be the initial choice, no, it should be oral hypoglycemic, most importantly, metformin. So now the treatment of first choice for chronic pancreatitis-related type 3C diabetes is metformin. If metformin do not work, then we can add on or switch over to different kinds of insulin. And then this is another new concept coming in chronic pancreatitis and diabetes. So the gut microbiome. So microbiome has been extensively studied in different diseases. And this is one of our studies where we tried to look at the microbiome in chronic pancreatitis and see if it is different from type 1 and type 2. Just concentrate on these Venn diagrams. If you see here, type 3C diabetes have 63 unique species of the microbiome compared to the type 1 and type 2 diabetes. So what does this altered microbiome do? Again, this was a previous study where we showed that, again, the microbiome in diabetes related to chronic pancreatitis patient had a totally different microbiome compared to patient of chronic pancreatitis without microbial dysbiosis. And the most important organism that was seen to be altered was something called Faecalibacterium prausnitzii, so which was significantly low in patients with chronic pancreatitis with diabetes compared to those without diabetes. And Faecalibacterium prausnitzii is responsible, you must have read this about this in IBD literature, inflammatory bowel disease literature. This organism is responsible for maintaining the gut barrier. It produces lots of short chain fatty acids that give nutrient to the colonic epithelial cell and also the bacteria. So once Faecalibacterium prausnitzii gets depleted or do not function well, the gut barrier integrity gets disrupted and there is more and more dysbiosis in the organisms because of lack of adequate nutrition. And when the Faecalibacterium this gets depleted, there is increased expression of the LPS pathway, and that LPS, which is endotoxin, goes into the blood. And then in these patients, actually the endotoxin level in the blood negatively correlated with prausnitzii, meaning that if there is more Faecalibacterium prausnitzii, there is more if it is less Faecalibacterium prausnitzii, there is more endotoxin, and endotoxin correlated very strongly with blood glucose. So if we link this three up, dysbiosis causing less Faecalibacterium prausnitzii, more endotoxemia, and more diabetes. So this is a new concept in the development of diabetes in chronic pancreatitis. So probably sometime in the future, one of the possible treatment for diabetes could be gut microbial manipulation. We have to do more trials on that, and I can't comment that much on now, but that is a potential future therapy. So finally, last two, three slides would be on depression. So recent studies have shown that chronic pancreatitis patients have depression, have poor quality of life, and there were some association between the pain, depression, quality of life. But what is not known is what connects the mental state, quality of life, and emotional factors in these patients. So this was something that we had been working on, I think last three, four slides left. In the last 3 years, I'm not going against details of the study. It was a large sample size of 625. We conducted different things like magnetic resonance spectroscopy of the brain, looked at plasma metabolites, did complete phenotyping of the disease. And then we also, a subgroup of patients, we started teaching them about their disease. We discussed them about their disease, like what they're suffering from, what could be their outcomes, why they're having pain, and answered all their questions. It was like 40, 30, 35 minutes affair. And then we called them back and saw how they behaved in terms of pain and quality of life. So here, if we see chronic pancreatitis, more than almost half of the patient would have some kind of depression, almost half had, majority mild depression followed by moderate. And this is something called a violin plot, may look complex, but here what is shown here in this plot is all the quality of life parameters, like the global score, the emotional score, the cognitive status of the patient, they were significantly poorer in patients who had depression. And the system score, symptom score, like the pain and constipation, diarrhea, all those are more prolific in patients who had depression. So this depression had a bearing on their quality of life. Now, when we looked at the brain metabolites, if you see this panel, the third panel, so this indicates the wave, the different metabolites in the brain, N-acetyl, aspartate, creatine, and in healthy controls. And this indicates the N-acetyl, aspartate, and different metabolites in the depression patient, which is significantly depleted. And that poor metabolite correlated very nicely with the emotional and cognitive function, which means that if the patient has chronic pancreatitis, there, because of the pain, there will be depletion of these metabolites that leads to depression and poor quality of life. So when we educated this patient about their disease, if you see, this was pre-education depression and pain, and this was post-education, and this was so intriguing. If you see here, after the education, significant majority of patients did not have depression, pain was gone in majority of the patient, and severity reduced in another majority of patients. Right. So if you look at that after education, after educating the patient, the BDI, the depression score was decreased. The number of painful days and pain episodes were significantly low. The pain score was low. And more importantly, the emotional function improved in these patients after education. So what does it mean? So does it mean that this patient should be treated with antidepressant in the routine practice? We don't have enough data now, but any other effective strategy, patient education, or what we call it as personalized education or counseling, what happens when we counsel the patient, when the patient understands their disease, probably there is some change in the metabolites in the brain, and then they start coping with the pain, because counseling won't reduce inflammation in the pancreas. Something has to be happening with the metabolites in the brain. And what we believe is, and we are trying to prove that in an ongoing randomized controlled trial, once the patient understands their disease, they start coping with the pain. So even if they have pain, they cope it better, and that leads to a better emotional status. So with this, I think I'll end and acknowledge several people who had worked with me at some point of time. So the left-hand names are all the DNB students. The blue ones have already passed out. They are doing very well else in different thesis, and these lower ones are still working. Some of them will be going for exam this time, have gone for the exam this time, and they have worked with me in different projects. And the right-hand people are from the basic science labs, my lab, which is funded by the Wellcome DBT. The top ones are still working. The lower ones, most of them have completed, and now they are elsewhere, most of them in US doing postdoc PhDs. Thank you, and I'd be happy to take questions.
See, thanks, Roopjyoti, for an excellent talk. I think those who have heard him would understand that this was much beyond the textbooks. Certain issues about depression, anxiety, nutrition, which are usually not discussed, have been brought into the highlight. We have only 2 minutes left, but I would request Mr. Singh to extend this by about maybe 3-4 minutes more, so that the answers to the chat box questions can be taken up by Dr. Roopjyoti. So you have the chat box, Roopjyoti.
So you will pick up the questions, or shall I?
Yeah, we can quickly go through them. That the first question was, any effect of morphine or tramadol on sphincter of Ehlers-Danlos dysfunction? Sphincter of Ehlers-Danlos, sorry.
Yeah, so morphine can have a sphincter of Ehlers-Danlos contraction. Tramadol do not have. That's what we have seen in clinical practice and from studies. But morphine can have some sphincter of Ehlers-Danlos dysfunction, especially if the patient is having acute exacerbation. Morphine may cause more pain. So
the next question, Roopjyoti, is that how does it matter if we diagnose early chronic pancreatitis? Can we really change the natural history of the disease?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Actually, it's difficult to give you a definite objective answer, but if we diagnose them early, if we try to reduce the inflammation, high dose of antioxidants, or maybe early endotherapy if they have some ductal obstruction. So if the inflammation comes down, the disease appears to slow down. That is what we have observed over the last 10 years in our clinical practice. But one needs to really do a very good quality study, which will be difficult, long-term follow-up, large number of patients, logistics and thing. But we believe early onset of early aggressive therapy could reduce the speed of the disease or slow down the progression.
So there are a number of questions on PERT therapy. When should we start PERT? How do we know whether it's working or not working? Is there any role for PERT in acute pancreatitis or resolving acute pancreatitis? Yeah. And how long do we continue then?
Yeah, okay, I'll quickly answer one by. So I did not include too many of because of the lack of time again. So in acute pancreatitis, in mild, it is obviously not working. If the patient has 80% or more of necrosis, in acute pancreatitis, acute necrotizing pancreas. In those patients, exocrine insufficiency features are seen after 6 to 12 months. So in those patients who have 80% or more of necrosis, they can be treated with a short course of pancreatic enzymes. That is helpful. In chronic pancreatitis, if the patient on imaging have a good chunk of parenchyma, duct is clear, those patients do not require pancreatic enzyme supplementation. Again, as I already said, it's difficult to objectively diagnose this problem in India. So what needs to be done is going by clinical, a combination of clinical and imaging modalities. If the patient has gross atrophy, a tight stricture or obstructive ductal stone, accompanied by weight loss or some signs of vitamin deficiency, those are the right patient where you can right away start exocrine therapy, replacement therapy without even doing elastase. How to see the response? Again, the breath test is the right test to look at response. Again, we do not have that in India. So in our setting, it is clinical. If the patient is improving after the nutrition, after the PERT therapy, gaining weight, having the vitamin deficiency symptoms are reducing. So that is a soft or surrogate marker of improvement of PERT.
So there's a good question, I think. What about combining PPI with PERT? We have been combining PPI with initial PERT therapy. The modified way of delivering PERT, do we still need PPI?
Yes, sir. PPI, I personally feel, and again, if we look at the preparations are the currently available for PERT is enteric coated microsphere preparation. And enteric coating is given to reduce degradation by the gastric acid. And by its pharmacokinetics, it should dissolve or it should start releasing the enzymes in the duodenum where the physiological pH should be around 5.5. But in chronic pancreatitis, it's not only SNR problem, also the ductal secretion comes down, bicarbonate comes down. So the gastric, the acidity in the duodenum may not come up to 5.5. Therefore, in the duodenum, there is a risk of degradation of the enteric coated preparation by the gastric acid. So use of a PPI is important. In my practice, I always use a PPI, and I think if we use a PPI, the action of the enzymes will be better.
Yeah, so this.
Sir, I lost your voice.
Sir, what's the first analgesic? I think you did talk about first analgesic to be used in chronic pancreatitis. You did talk about paracetamol being tried in some of the cases.
Yeah, but I think a good way to begin is use of tramadol hydrochloride or tapentadol. Now we have tapentadol. So those two are good ways to start. Tramadol we can give as injection also if needed. If the patient is very refractory and has severe pain, then we may try a fentanyl patch. Usually in that combination, it usually comes down, and then we can shift over to the long-term management.
Then there are certain questions which are actually not discussed today, is that what's the role of how do you manage a pancreatic ascites and cirrhosis with no ductal communication on MRC?
In chronic pancreatitis, pancreatic ascites, there should be some communication. So initially, it's very important because it's very unlikely just because there has to be some sidebrush communication in chronic pancreatitis for ascites to be there, pancreatic ascites. So we can decompress, we can reduce the fluid, you can draw the fluid. And if there is no communication with good nutritional therapy, high protein diet, it should not relapse. But if there is a communication is documented, then of course we'll have to go for a transpapillary stenting. And that's...
I think there are a couple of other questions which I think we don't have time to take over. But thank you very much, Dr. Talukdar, for a very exciting discussion today.
Thank you.
Thank you.